drillings, whether it's a bow drill, hand drill, whatever, if your powder starts to come out and look like pepper, little grains of pepper, it's probably going to have a very high ignition level, and I'd look for another piece of wood. Especially my age. I want it as easy as I can get it.
What you're looking for is stuff like powdered sugar.
Flowering stalks in our area of yuccas and beargrass work. Excellent. This is a root of a cedar tree. Today, because you have so many around here, this is the seed. Seed stem, I guess, of a palm tree.
Oh, okay.
And have all these leaves.
Oh, the stalk of the palm?
Of the stem of the seed pod.
That has the seeds.
Okay,
on.
I know what you mean. Yeah.
If you take the leaf off, you can get a fire with the leaf, the central part of the leaf, but it's harder.
We have those in town, but not up here in the hills. Yeah.
Yeah, we saw them all over the place coming through town.
Yeah.
It's hard not to stop.
Yeah.
Great stuff.
We just use stone tools
today, and of course the sequence is just gouge a hole, gouge a depression, and today I'm going to just kneel and do it. We have some people in the audience I know already know how to do this, and have different ways. Some people sit. The Bushmen, the San Bushmen in the Kalahari, they squat. In the Amazon, they squat. Maasai do it on one knee, which is a popular way among Americans because of their body structure. They like to do this on one knee.
So Chris, you guys all see what he did? He's got
Chris,
two plants for pieces of wood.
Well, I do the floating technique, but there's a lot of different ways that
I... But do you kneel or one knee or sit with your foot? Or?
Most of the time I just put one foot down and I'll sort of half kneel.
But yeah, okay. That's a popular way. Uh-huh. You notice I'm spitting on my hands. What the spit does is it starts to dry, it gets tacky. When I go to spin, I have a tackiness on the drill because I'm spinning and I'm also pushing down. So I want to do both of those.
You're starting at the small end, working to the big end.
The big end goes down.
Big end goes down, yeah.
I'll talk to Al about that.
And I'm looking for a little smoke.
Halcon.
What he's using is a drill right now. Here it's called mule fat.
See the smoke?
It's called mule fat here. Yeah. It's sepal. Looks like what you got right there.
Yeah, we found mule fat.
Yeah. For most people, the reason they drill first is where do you put the notch? For Al, the reason I drill first is I want to see what the level of smoke comes out, and that tells me the humidity of the wood. To me, humidity is a killer. So if smoke comes out slowly, I may protract the operation. I may drill a little more before I even do the notch and allow conduction to heat up the area of the heart where we're going to do the drilling. I can use a stone tool like this, or you can get a little clever and put a stone tool in a stick and use it like a saw, and that works well.
You can get more modern.
Yeah, but this is to show you that our ancestors really could do these kind of things quite well with stone tools.
Is that, a hoko knife you're using, Al?
That's what they call it. Other cultures had it too, but yeah. In California, the hoko culture are known for this. Yes. Okay, so now I have a depression. I got some pretty good powder off of it, very fine. I have a notch. Powder's going to fall into the notch. This is the tinder we're using. We have a bundle, some meets of bundles. And in fact, this is juniper. And he's passing around cottonwood bark in this side.
Juniper. This is juniper. That's the tinder cottonwood bark from dead and rotten cottonwood trees.
Yeah.
Wherever. Cottonwood.
It's everywhere. I think harvested it way north. Okay. Again, a little moisture on the drill. One thing about fire is once you get to where you're doing it, don't ever get cocky about it. First time you think you're the daddy, it'll fail you.
See, that's what you should tell
first out. Time, it'll fail you. So,
that's going to be a tough one.
You need to know, am I the daddy or is this fireboard the daddy today?
You're the daddy.
Well, we'll see. Get some smoke going.
Mom,
see the smoke? Now I say, who's your daddy?
That's for the daddy.
I'm daddy today. Do I have an ember? See it smoking? That's a sustained chain reaction. If I don't do anything, that'll just eat up all of that dust until it is burned away.
That's like the glow on the end of a cigarette. That's not flame yet. We have to do something to make it into a flame. That's what the tinder bundle's for.
Yeah. This ember's kind of like the end of a cigarette.
Hey, Al, I don't want you to say anything to Alan Halcom, but that was quicker than Alan.
Well, that's because I'm older.
The older you get, the better you get.
I would say that. I think Al Halcom is the fastest driller I've ever known.
He is pretty quick.
Very fast.
The older you get, the faster you have to be.
That's a good point.
Before you expire.
We understand.
How important is the size of the...
Of the what?
Of the notch.
The notch has to be wide enough that the sawdust is going to fall down in it. And the air can get to it.
Oh, my God.
Your board needs to be thin enough.
Yeah.
Big pile of dust before the pile of dust reaches up to where the heat is.
Yeah. It's so easy a caveman can do it. This is cottonwood bark here. The one that went around that side, it'll come around.
See, you don't even have to blow on it.
Yeah, today.
No way.
Any questions on the hand drill? I used to keep track of what I could do a hand drill fire with in the Verde Valley. And in the Verde Valley alone, I got up to 24 separate drills. And I just quit recording it.
So your drill is mule fat there?
In this case, yes.
And the hearth is willow?
This case, it's seed palm.
Oh, seed palm, you said that, yeah, okay.
What do you call that thing that sticks up and has the seeds on it?
A frond?
The stem of the floral spike, you know.
Floral spike, okay. Because I've tried it with the centers of the leaves also, they're much more difficult.
Yeah.
You can do bow drilling with them, some hand drilling, but these are much less dense for some reason.
You got a question right there.
Yeah, so both the drill and the board should be softwoods?
Well, there's a lot of discussion about that. In my opinion, the board should be softer than the drill or equal. You never want your board, I don't think, to be harder than the drill. And I experimented with that with bow drilling. And I remember once getting all kinds of smoke and no fire, and I was using a hard board and a soft drill. Then I reversed the process. I carved the drill into a board, and I took the board and made a small drill, and I popped an ember immediately. So I'm one of those that believes that the bottom should be softer, or the same wood, or the same wood. But the key thing is got to be dry, and it's got to be as low density as possible. Some people say, well, soft, right? Well, soft is to botanists is a different thing. A soft wood is a conifer, and a hard wood is a deciduous. And yet, there are conifers that are much more physically hard than a cottonwood. So I just use less dense, low density woods. Question?
I presume that you're talking about the seed pod of the Mexican palm tree as opposed to a Canary Island or some of the others.
Whatever grows around
whatever
here.
Okay, probably the Mexican palm.
We don't have them in Arizona unless they've been planted somewhere.
You
drive around here and you see them everywhere.
Okay.
And I've collected these from Northern California all the way to leaving Bakersfield.
Okay.
Then you don't see any around Barstow or anything.
Wherever you live, you have to collect what's available and find out what works where you live.
That's a good point.
What is this again? This is stuff going around? Cottonwood bark?
One of those is cottonwood bark. The other one is
dead cottonwood.
That's cottonwood
bark.
It's on the inside of the bark of a dead cottonwood or part of a cottonwood tree that's died. That's the inside. It makes the cambium layer.
Is that your favorite technique?
Pardon?
Is that your favorite technique?
Okay. It's probably physically my favorite, but I'm most sympathetic to the fire saw. Or you want to do a hand? One thing about, we come at this a lot from anthropology. The hand drill, at least up to today, is probably the only method that they have found on every continent in the world. Every continent, including Australia. Now, Australia also had the fire saw and they had the fire plow. different cultures, but they also had the hand drill, especially near the rim of the island. The bow drill is a late comer. There is a bow drill set in England that's 6,000 years old, came out of Egypt. They've now found two bow drill sets in Anasazi country, not too far from where we are. They carbon dated around 1100 AD. To me, probably an indirect transference, a style used by Aztecs. When the Spaniards arrived in Tenochtitlan in Mexico, they were sacrificing people and doing bow drills in their chests while they pulled their hearts out. So they put in their chronicles about the bow drill. So the Aztecs had it. So we think the Anasazi probably got it from trading, indirect trading with cultures from central Mexico. And then, of course, we think it's also a method that developed independently in other places of the world. The bow drill being developed in Mexico, independent of it being developed, for example, in Egypt and India. He's going to do a strap drill. Oh, bow drill, okay.
You saw how easy he made that fire. Have any of you seen the movie Castaway with Tom Hanks in it?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, he tried and tried and tried and got bloody hands. Never did get a fire with a hand drill.
Should have gotten UPS.
I don't know why he didn't try this method.
Yeah, some of you know David Holliday. Teaches at Rabisig Wintertown for the Boulder Outdoor Survival School. He was an advisor on that film, and he recommended the bow drill because Tom Hanks, as a scout, could have been exposed to the bow drill much more readily. But the screenwriter, because the crash and all the incident takes place in Polynesia, he wanted a Polynesian method, so they went with a fire plow at the end. But as a practical matter, this is the method you probably would have used, a shoestring and a pocket knife.
Shoestring.
And this is the method we teach the Boy Scouts, and they all do very well with this. About age 12 to 14, Boy Scouts can pick this up, and we have great success after that with Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts. All of them.
Question. Is this something you can go out right now and find
yes.
on the ground and do?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
The bow drill isn't, right?
What?
You can do that too.
If you find a nice straight piece of wood, it might be a little bit on the hard side. Take turns. Two people kneel in front of it and do it. Something like that. But he found one the other day, brought it back, came and got here, cranked out a fire right on the spot. Just cut a piece of dry sea willow that was probably a couple years old. Okay. While he's getting ready there, here's a piece I just harvested the other day. And I harvest bushes green. I don't like to harvest them dead unless it's a survival situation. And then I look down the thing like that, and all right, a little bit bent there, a little bit bent here, bend it the other way, and then I put it on the couch or the bed in the house. I don't let it get a lot of heat. And next day I do it, and it's fighting me. About 3 or 4 days, it quits fighting. So I always, it's sheep willow harvested green. At the height of its expansion, early summer is the best time. You get the fastest embers, because then, as you go into the fall, the plant starts to reduce because moisture drops, and then it gets more dense. So the best time for me is to harvest is June or July or August, where I am. And these look like beauties here. I have to take a moment to test them, but these really look nice.
Basically, when you said stop fighting, are you trying to bend it a little each day so you get a place to sit in eventually?
Yeah, like right now, I have a little bend right there. I'll bend it out. It's gone. I'll pick it up tomorrow, and it'll be back again. Not quite as bad.
No fire, just...
a dead down one and had fire, I'd straighten it with fire just to use. But no, I don't straighten them with fire, not the green ones. And you'll get very straight, and they'll stay straight forever. I have a couple drills that go back 10 years I still use. And they've never made any attempt to bend on me.
Okay, for my fireboard, I'm using a flowering stock from a soap tree yucca or bear grass. It's kind of hard to tell looking at it. It's all cut up. And you see it's already got a bunch of holes already burned in it. Most people sat around their campsite and did this before they went out.
One question on your fire. How thick do you like it?
A half an inch for me is too big.
Okay.
And 3/8 is the bare minimum. Otherwise, I got skin on skin too much. And that's a very good point. I will harvest maybe 10 or 12 drills, and then I'll get two or three that are just perfect, and the rest are a little too big or a little too small. And I'm sure you have the same experience. And for me, just below a half inch and above 3/8, I'm in that zone for me. It's perfect for my hands.
The diameter of the drill? You talking about the diameter of the drill?
Yes. Yeah, a half an inch diameter for me is too big. But I have a friend that's a doctor in Phoenix. He likes a bigger drill. So whenever I have left over those sizes, I give them to him. And he's a hell of a good hand driller. Yeah. He just doesn't have time to go out and collect.
You see, the main disadvantage of a bow drill, all the parts you have to have. Hand drill, you had two parts, the drill and the hearth. So we got a bow, a drill, a bearing block, and a hearth. And a cord.
Show us what you're using for a bearing block, Mike.
In this case, it's an astragalus bone from a big elk.
Can you move that pan?
That's the ankle bone?
No, can you move that pan? Thanks.
Okay. You can use a rock that has a depression in it. You can use a piece of wood that's harder than this. And if you're out in the wilderness and you don't have any lubrication, you get the grease off your nose or behind your ears. Because you don't want friction on the end that's in your bearing. You want all the friction to develop the heat down in the fire end. Astragalus bones have natural lubrication in them.
The
body parts, they are the best.
Yeah.
Good thing about this is you get great big fat embers.
That was quick.
Yeah. Please don't make it look so easy.
Michael, have you done this before? a time or two.
This really is, in my opinion, everyone should who spends any time in the woods should learn this method.
Notice how he has the ember on a bark.
Some people have sandals, but most of us in the woods have shoelaces.
I always bring them
cordage. And you all have a pocket knife. Remember, a knifeless man is a lifeless man, so we all carry pocket knives of some kind. I always have at least three knives on me, too.
Fire.
Yeah.
Let me do a... Because I like the method because it's the first one I learned, and that's the fire saw. Generally, I don't prepare the materials until I get ready to start a fire, because bamboo is protected by its outer coating, like a silica coating, and so I don't expose it to the environment, especially in the jungles, until you want to use it. I cut these a little while ago to save us time. Use a real shallow notch. I use real thin-walled bamboo. The bigger diameter, the better. But you can't always get all that. And if I learned this, by the way, from the Negritos in the Philippines, who are really properly called Aitas. And their average height is, maybe an inch or two. I've never seen one 5 feet tall, never. And I've never seen one reach 100 pounds. So they taught me a method where you actually get on top of the saw and drill it. And it's a different method than a lot of people teach in the States. Let me jump on this one real quick, see how we do.
There are many different methods to hold your bamboo. We're going to do one that's really expedient. I'm just going to hold the end of it for him.
Yeah. He probably doesn't have to, but if I can keep the bamboo from rocking, it will save energy, make the process a touch faster. Otherwise, I'll jam that against a rock or I'll jam it against a tree. Now, this method was used with a lot of other woods. In Australia, they used tree roots, like bottle tree, and they would split the root, put a piece of wood or a wedge in there, and they put kangaroo dung in the crease. And then the two pieces would be like this together with a space, dung, cut a notch, turn it over, and they would do this. And the most common bottom piece or saw would be their warrings, or their what we would call an addle. They were wider, and they would that was, in essence, a piece of fire-making equipment. And they have no problems at all with this. I've done it in my area with yucca on maple, bear grass on bear grass. I've done it even with the flowering stalks of agave a little bit thin, but I've gotten fires with them. Okay, I think we're ready. Let's see how we do. A lot of wind today, but let's see how we do. And this is takes a little bit of patience. I don't want to crush that little tinder bundle.
This method is very physically demanding.
And so you have to learn to enjoy it. You have to learn to ride with it.
They always do it horizontally like that?
They always what?
They always do it horizontally?
No. No, I'll show you a couple other ways.
So the heat just comes up through the bottom and catches the tinder?
We gotta go.
And the embers formed on both sides of the notch.
When the ember, it comes up from the bottom. It goes up into the...
Got it, Michael?
Yeah.
The muscles on that dude. Yeah.
Triceps.
No.
You guys, don't be surprised if you don't do it that quick.
Now, let me catch my breath.
That's awesome.
I showed this to Christopher last year. He said, well, let me try it. He jumped on there and knocked out an ember faster than I did. Then he walks away. No big thing. You remember that?
Yeah, no, but I couldn't do it on my own. So there was the magic touch.
Now the question is, there is another school that'll do this on their chest. They'll do it like this. Jam it against their chest, and they'll drill like this on their knees. Works well. Barry Keegan, back in New York, jammed it against his side, against a tree trunk, and does it like this. Me, because of my age and my weight, I have to get on top of it like an Aita does. And that's how they do it. They put it on the ground. 90-pound Aita gets on here and knocks it off in about 15 seconds. And it's just stunning to watch them do it. But I don't think they could do it like this. But I think you could, for example. I think you could do it like that because you're big. You got the build.
He won't fatten up. He refuses to fatten up.
Not a liar.
Why don't you show him the strap drill?
I'll show you my favorite method. This is the method I use all the time. I have a woodworking shop at home. In the wintertime, I start my fires. And Al and I are in search and rescue. Never leave home without a big lighter, but that doesn't mean I use it. And I keep my fire kit right here in this pocket. This is the only one that's got a strap on it. Got all my important stuff in it. Dog cookies.
Oh yeah.
My fire kit.
Now, Zach, now.
Look how small it is.
That's not for me.
Well, he's getting ready. Borrowed some mugwort from the young lady over here. You have mugwort out here, they're just unbelievable. Our mugwort grows about, maybe a foot tall. It's wonderful stuff. Your stuff out here is almost like 4 feet tall. I'm just stunned by it. And it's great for all kinds of things besides ember extenders, but we really like it for fire. And in fact, we make slow matches with it. While he's getting ready, a slow match is just a bunch of bark, like cottonwood bark, all wrapped, and right down the center of it, you put mugwort or you put fungus, like this is off of cottonwood and willows and cottonwoods. Right down the center, light one end, and 16 inch will last 4 hours. So you go 4 hours, comes out the other end, you either light another one or you start your fire. And that's a bad weather method of carrying fire, at least in Arizona. Apaches did it all the time.
So this is basically very similar to a bow drill. Same hard cord. A shorter drill, you can use a shorter drill, a longer one so you don't get smoke in your face. It just depends on where you want to carry it. Up north, they put them in their pouch inside their seal skins to keep it dry. Oh, yeah.
In fact, come up later, look at the display. This all here is, this is an Inuit fire kit. This is an Inuit drill where they stuck a nail in it because they use this to drill holes for their kayaks and everything. It's an Inuit fireboard where you don't have to make notches. You just make two holes and the ember falls from one hole into the other.
Whoa.
He's holding the stick. Explain the stick in the mouth, Al.
Yeah.
How's he holding the bearing block?
Okay,
don't know.
Good point. If you're at the basket and you hold it with your front teeth like this, and with bite wings.
Okay.
Whoops. If you're an Inuit, you hold it in your molars back here. This is best for us. I have an overbite. This works beautifully. I have trouble with the bite wing because it makes my head jump up and down.
It fell off of here, but anyway, that's how you do it. Very similar to the bow drill.
Now, is there a reason why it's so small? Is that just portability?
Portability.
Yes. Yeah.
They wore it in their pouches around their neck.
Yeah.
Picks them up in camp, put them over their heads like this, inside their shirt. Inside here will be a mouthpiece, a couple small drills, a couple cords, and sphagnum moss. That was their moss, dried sphagnum. And then they always had fire. And you can understand the importance of fire here. Think how important it is up in the northern edges of Canada. Oh yeah.
No real difference.
No, they just would prepare their kits and their fireboards will have a whole string of holes and notches ready to go. And
is it more energy conservative?
I think it is.
It's easy.
And the other thing is. Their thinking up there is, we need to be able to make fire by ourselves. In other words, if he and I are out on a hike or walking on a hunt, he falls in the water, he's useless. I can grab him and pull him out, but I got to get a fire started right away by myself.
Hypothermic.
And so they went from the other methods, like the Malaysians have a method that's two man. One person holds the bearing block and the fireboard. The other person wraps a couple wraps around the string and does this. And that's exactly the antecedent to this method. But when you get up into the North Country, you've got to be able to do it by yourself. So that, we think there's a lot behind why they use this method. Is you know, if you've got a couple people, you can do it with help, but it's something you can do by yourself.
That's called the scribe drill.
By the way, in Alaska, in Canada, Northern Canada, it's the only place in the world we know of where cultures had at least two ways to make fire. At least two ways. All the other places, they did hand drilling, they were happy with it. And so you either had a little bit of bow drilling, not a lot, some hand drilling. You had this method, almost every culture had the strap drill. And a number of cultures had this method. And this is just fire by iron pyrite. And Point Barrow, Alaska, has some really nice iron pyrites. And they were traded all over the northern countries. From Siberia all the way to New England. They found pyrite trades all the way down to prehistoric New England. Do you have any more on the strap drill?
No.
Okay. Let me do a real quick, because this is also European. This is a Celtic method before the Romans arrived and showed them how to use the flint and steel. And it's just a chunk of iron sulfide. It looks silver, it's called marcasite, but really it's the same as the stuff we get in Arizona, only it's formed differently. It's formed as concretions, rhomboidal concretions, and very common in Alaska, common in the southern part of South America. Tierra de Fuego had three cultures that used this method, and then very common in Northern Europe until they went to flint and steel. Very, very Celtic, for example. And the method has been, at least the Magdalenian culture, we're talking 22,000 years ago, they're finding it in Magdalenian culture graves. But so far, only in the male graves. It's kind of interesting. Apparently, it was not something that culturally the women did, or this method was something they didn't do. I'm not sure.
Maybe an addition.
Say that again. You don't want to say that too loud. So let me, the disadvantage today is, and when they found them in the graves, they always found a seashell. What we think happened is they were taking enonotus, another type of fungus, which you get on birch trees, dead birch trees. If you look at it, it looks like a bear bent over and shot his poop on the tree. But when you pull it off, the inside is golden color. And you can take a stone and do this, and it'll come out as a powder. And we think what they were doing is putting powder in the shell and then striking sparks into the powder. This method does work with all kinds of light materials. I've lit goose down, duck down, I've lit a whole variety of fungus or fungi, fox hair, inner hair of fox, just anything that will take a spark. Thistles work really well. Again, thistles have to be padded with nose grease or ear grease or something. Pad them tight, and they'll take it. What you do is you just strike this thing, and you won't see the sparks. I'm going to drive sparks into that, and you won't see the sparks. They're just so dull red.
At nighttime, you'll see them.
Yeah, if you go in the bathroom or something at night, turn all the lights off, yeah, you'll see them. Well, I'm going to have trouble with the wind here.
What's the rock called again, Al?
Called marcasite.
Marcasite.
Yeah. Well, let's see.
Oil the way?
Go ahead. Let me see what happens.
Okay.
Yeah, you can do it.
Try real quick.
And then you look for smoke. No smoke?
Okay.
Do it again.
You ever use that case?
Any smoke coming up?
No.
Okay, so what you do is you grab a tinder bundle, you let that smolder a little bit, get some fungus if you want to. You guys go to McDonald's, supersize it. So you supersize your bundle like this. And then you don't want to waste all of that, so take some kind of straight edge. Save what you can for the next time. Put that in there. The heat from this is a little lower, and the ember smaller than the hand drill or bow drill in those methods. So a little bit of fungus inside really helps a lot. And then the rest of this stuff you just save, put it back in the baggie. And I cannot tell you how many things I have found that I can light. Even really dry elk dung will light.
You see, he's not in a hurry to put that ember into a flame, because it'll just sit there and smolder. And actually grow, it'll get bigger.
Wow.
Can you imagine?
Amazing.
Well, if you've seen the movie Quest for Fire, the book ends differently than the movie. And the book ends with the guy showing up with this method into a culture that did hand drills. Can you imagine a guy hand drilling and then seeing somebody do this? And it'd be like washing clothes with your hands and somebody giving you an electric washer.
Hey Al, that was pretty historically accurate, wasn't it? That movie.
Yeah, yes, it was an excellent movie.
Yeah.
That's probably my favorite movie of all time.
What's it called?
But
I agree with
you. Fire.
another point I want to make with this is that there is a process in anthropology we call pre-adaptation. So here we have marcasite, then you have the Romans come into town, and they bring fire steel. And the Celtics look at this, or whatever other Germanic tribes might be there, whoever. And they watch the Romans light fire like this, and they say, well, that's no big deal. We've been doing it with stones forever. It's just a piece of char cloth. That's a lie. So then the Celtics look at this and look at this and say, well, you haven't done anything for us. We know how to do that. And then the next step is you come into our culture, and I'll use this one. And you have the metal match, which is our pre-adaptation to this system. Finally, we have, again, another way of making sparks, but for lighters. So it's a sort of a pre-adaptation process from Magellanian times all the way to modern times for the smokers, or anybody that uses lighters, which is kind of interesting. We like fires, but you never catch either one of us without a lighter in our pockets. If you're on a search and rescue, you need a fire right away. These are games. You've got to get a fire started because somebody might be going down with hypothermia. We like this stuff, but we understand its place in history and its place in what we do for people out there.
Since we are in search and rescue, we want stuff that works, no matter what.
Yeah. Is there a certain temperature that a lighter won't work?
If a lighter gets wet, it will not work.
No, a certain temperature? Is there a temperature that...
There are some lighters that, at severe cold weather, they don't work. Yes. Butane has great difficulty at real low temperatures. Have these other types of lighters you can use, but most of us carry them in our pockets anyway, so our body heat keeps them warm. So that's not a problem. It's if the lighter was kept somewhere else, like in the, somewhere in your backpack, it might not work. One thing I wanted to show you all is nothing to do with so much the anthropology. Is have you all seen the storm match?
Yeah.
The storm match. If you do not have a storm match or two in your pack, rethink. Because, again, this is I was on a search, I'll make it a long story, and in the middle of the night, and it was along the Verde, searching for a missing boy. The radio call came in, send your dog team back, and Cornell, you cross the river and join the team on the other side and continue on with them. So I go to cross the river at the widest point, and all of a sudden I'm in 15 feet of water. And everything I had was wet, soaking wet. And I decided at that point, I couldn't do it, I couldn't light a fire or anything. I had to have stuff with me that would light. So think about carrying cotton balls impregnated with Vaseline. It's great. If we had more time, or when you come to our camp, we'll do that. We just throw the balls in the water, pull them right out, strike a metal match in them. We'll show you how it works, because you have to open them up. And a wonderful method of lighting something completely soaking wet. But I like the storm match because it's pretty windy right now. And the wind won't blow it out. Look, I'm going to stick it in the water. Three lights. That's awesome. I can't believe this. Everyone should. And if you're in a group of people, go buy a couple of them and split them. They're not waterproof, so we coat them with Nu Skin. That stuff you paint cuts with. Dries in about 5 minutes, and it's highly flammable, Nu Skin. It's the easiest method over fingernail polish and paraffin and those other things. But, yeah, this is just an awesome way to light a fire, because even if it's raining, it's not going to go out. The match will not go out. So.
What was it called?
It's called, well, these are called stormproof matches. And we've seen them at Cabela's, REI, an outfitter near us called the Manzanita in Prescott, they have them. Seen them in a lot of different places. And now a couple other companies are making them besides this one. Really becoming quite the popular match to have because it will relight if it's wet. Rain falls on it, it relights.
Make sure you waterproof it before it gets wet.
Yeah.
If it gets wet before you light it, it will not work.
So I'm sorry. You buy them and then you waterproof them.
Yeah. With new even if it says waterproof on the box, don't believe them. Okay. What they mean waterproof is that if it rains on it, it'll still work. If it falls in a bucket of water. Changes the chemistry of the match head. You can't even dry it out and use it. It changes the chemistry of the match head.
How about the NATO matches? You know, you've seen those in the little plastic containers. You pull the little top off.
I was in the Navy for 20 years. Every single waterproof box that I opened up in the Navy was full of water.
Well, my MOS was bilge rat, and I was a bilge rat, and I found a little bit of difference there, but that's okay. Everybody has their own.
Well, I'm not familiar with the match you're talking about.
I worked in electronics, so every box that I opened, there was a problem with.
Yeah.
And the problem was water.
Yeah.
I didn't open boxes unless they had problems.
When also, that little thing you could buy at the store.
Just the head or? When you coat them, do you coat just the head or all the whole thing?
All of it. If the bottom gets damp, the wood, it'll go right up the wood to the head. Yeah, if you dunk the first print in, let it dry, then dunk the other half in. Yeah. And you don't have to do a whole box. Do six or eight. I mean, it's, how often are you going to get caught out in the rain? Maybe on a hike or something. Not that often. So you don't have to do
depends
a
depends on where Alan Howe comes at me next.
I just do a half a dozen, keep in the back.
Another good emergency item to carry is one of these metal matches. Don't get a little bitty one. If you're hypothermic, you won't be able to hold it. Get something you can hold. Even if you're hypothermic, you can hold that with your whole fist and fingers like this.
This happened to me once. I was in Idaho. I got up in the morning and everything was wet. Took up my metal match, and I had this small one. There's some guy here in California. His nickname is Sparky. I don't know if some of you are aware of him. And I always thought, well, this is a cool metal match because it's nice and small and doesn't take any space. I couldn't hold it. My hands were too cold. I had lost all my fine motor skills, and I couldn't do that. I have found with the one he's talking about, this one, I can make a fist with this hand, a mitt, and I can take a striker and make a mitt with this hand like that. I can get sparks. So he's right. Something can be too small to be effective.
Okay. We have a lot of modern methods that we'll talk about over in our campsite, but there's one technique I want to show you. What if you have a broken hand? How can you start a fire with one hand?
Lighter.
What if you don't have a lighter? What if your lighter's wet?
Ash sticks.
Create a clamp with your foot.
Take your knife.
Bring your buddy.
I normally have cotton balls saturated with Vaseline. If they're saturated in Vaseline, even if they're not, the best way to get a fire is to pull it apart. Get these very fine fibers. The fine fibers that are going to catch first, and the Vaseline will sustain the fire so that it won't even dry out wet. Say you have a broken hand. You have to put your foot behind it, hold it.
This is just for grins. Coughlin's used to make a fire kit with potassium permanganate, and I think they got scared because they quit. But this is a chemical fire, and just for fun, let's just crank one up here. And it is. I'm going to put some potassium permanganate in this sticker bundle.
You can still buy that, though, right?
Yeah, you can buy it, but you have to buy it in larger amounts, I think at least a minimum of a half a pound. And then, yeah, it's coming out as a powder. Make sure you pack everything up so they don't touch each other. They can get you the glycerin. This is glycerin. I've not known any that could give me the potassium permanganate, but you go on a website, there's all kinds of companies, chemical companies, that sell it, and will mail it to you. Pardon?
Pharmacies have this one.
Do they? Okay. Anyway, put a few drops on top of the little divot there. Put a few drops there on top, and
can't take it to the airport.
I'm not sure the airport would even know what it was, but because they have a rule, liquid must be below so many ounces. You could probably walk through with this little bottle and they wouldn't even know. So let's see what happens. And the colder it is, especially the glycerin, the longer this takes. But it will always go off. So don't walk away from it thinking, well, it's not going to work. It will work.
Oh, wow.
I've seen it take 10 minutes to go off in a real cold day. Just for grins, anyone wants to do it over a campsite, come on over.
We'll potassium permanganate and glycerin.
This is glycerin and potassium permanganate, yeah.
What else would you have potassium permanganate for?
Well, good question. Why would you even make it? It has sort of like four levels of usage. It can be used for cleaning, disinfecting pools. It can be used for cuts and abrasions. You just mix more potassium with water than less. You can use it antifungal, but then you want it to be really dark purple, and it'll kill fungus on your feet. But you don't want that dark purple for cuts. You want it more of a rosy color for cuts, or a lighter color for cuts. But yeah, it's very good medicinally. You probably knew that.
Is there any drawback to use it for purple dye?
Purple dye? I don't know.
Is it really staying steady?
Don't know. Yeah.
It's also easy to explosive.
Anyway, it's kind of an interesting way if you've never seen a chemical fire. There's other ways using what do they put that stuff they put in radiators?
Antifreeze.
Yeah, antifreeze and some things like that work. You can take potassium permanganate and sugar crystals together, mix them all up, take something like the end of a knife and rub them real hard with some tinder, and it'll light the tinder. I've done that. In fact, I have some in here if anyone wants to flavor that over at the campsite. here. So we went through a whole bunch of different ways. Any questions?
Yes.
Shoot.
You were lighting the fire one-handed with your knife. Does the knife have to be carbon steel?
Yes.
Okay.
No. Oh, you mean stainless steel won't work?
Stainless steel will not work.
Oh, I didn't think of that. That's right.
High carbon stainless steel will probably work. But
yeah.
Regular stainless
steel. No, I see what you're talking about. Yeah. No, I was thinking about protection of the knife. You're talking about the spark.
You need
the carbon steel for the spark. Yeah. Good point. Good question.
And yeah, you say this is going to dull your knife. So what? If an emergency situation is going to save your life.
I don't care about carbon steel sharpens faster anyway.
Yeah.
Of course. Yeah. Carbon steel knives are the best to have.
Most of us prefer carbon steel over stainless. A very attentive audience. Thank you very much. We're going to be over there. Come on over, make the fire kit.
If you guys have not seen his charts, he's got examples of hearths, different kind of woods, and different kind of drill material. So come up and take a look at that. And you can make it and do these things over at his campsite. If he's over the other side, there's that red trailer of yours, right?
Yeah. The one with the rock art on it, yeah.
And remember, you could take home a little Arctic strap drill. They'll show you how to make it, and you could work with them in trying to do it. And but you have to tell us what Ek-Cha means, his Ek-Cha Fire Society. Now, is it a secret society that requires some special ritual to become a member?
No. One night at a fire up at Rabbit Stick, a bunch of us decided Ek-Cha is the Mayan merchant guy. And he's shown his symbolism in the codexes is he's kneeling, doing a hand-drilled fire with a pack on his back. And more than likely, the pack is filled with cacao beans, because that was sort of the currency of the day. But that's his symbol, so we just kind of adopted that term, Ek-Cha. We have a little flag with the Mayan merchant god on it.
Well, come on over and make fire and learn how to make bracelets also. Anytime, drop in. As long as we're there, we'll help you out.
We'll have lunch in 15 or 20 minutes or so. So thank you all for listening to us. It was a really good presentation, you guys.
Did you KO?
Mm-hmm.
Where is this
from? The local culture lived in Northern California.
Badger paws.
And what is this? The
badger paw. That's front of our.
No, that's our.
I just
want
to make a
call mixed with elk dung.
That makes a strong elk dung.
What happened is trying to pick up.